Hello everyone, welcome to another session. Today we're gonna learn how to set up K3S, which is a Kubernetes cluster on a Linux virtual machine. K3S is basically a very lightweight yet very easy to install Kubernetes cluster. And I was really surprised to know about this while I was using some other Kubernetes distributions such as Minikube and Kind and so on. But this is really something I want to share it with you as it is really helpful, especially for those who are trying to learn Kubernetes but always have this problem like how to install the services, the packages, the requirements, the configuration, and then sometimes it never happens and it is always a painful process to do all of this thing, while K3S provide just one line command to set it up all and just there you can run it directly on your machine. So let's get started with the today's agenda. First, we're going to talk about a small intro on K3S as how it works, what its requirements, how to use it, and so on. Then we jump to the installation part as how to install it on a Linux virtual machine. Then we will try to run K3S, and for testing, we will deploy a Nginx server using YAML configuration file. A small intro about me. My name is Usman Ahmad and I work in Grafana Labs as a senior developer advocate, and I have been working with the IT industry for more than 15 years, and now I'm really trying to share my knowledge and experience with all of you, especially for those who are new to this field or trying to learn the most top topics in the market for jobs such as Kubernetes, Docker, Linux, and also using tools for monitoring such as Grafana. I have created some of those videos in the past, so please check it out. And you can connect with me via LinkedIn and other social networks. I will write it down in the video description, so please check it out. So yeah, let's get started. So I have created this guide where I have explained how to install and configure K3S on a Linux machine. So for introduction, K3S is really lightweight. It is used for monitoring resources in environments which are running on IoT devices, or maybe you need a small cluster, a Kubernetes cluster, so you can use K3S there. Or you can use K3S on your normal laptop to deploy and test stuff as well. On their K3S website, they already says lightweight Kubernetes. And all you need is just this curl command to make it up and running. It is really great for edge IoT, as we just talked, for CI and ARM. And this is how it works. This is really nice picture how it all works. So we're not going in much detail. You can definitely check out their documentation page as well. It was originally developed by Rancher, which is now acquired by SUSE. K3S now is also a part of CNCF project, so this means that it is getting the right attention in the CNCF landscape, which is really good for its growth and future releases. Advantages. So K3 offers several advantages over Minikube and Kind. I was also one of those users who use Minikube, but one thing which I really struggle is that Minikube, even though at that time was lightweight, but in compare with K3S, it is K3S definitely more lightweight and resource efficient. And the second thing, which I think the most important, it is really easy to install and manage. In K3S, you just need a single line command, while in Minikube, you always need to set up some services and then do a lot of installation of packages. And sometimes you don't find the right packages on your distribution and so on. And it was a big hassle and there was a big learning curve as well. But with K3S, it's not. They really make it really simple. It also offers services like high availability, which is really cool. Integrated add-ons. So K3S comes with integrated add-ons for load balancing for your cluster. This is really helpful because sometimes you need to configure these services by yourself, and it takes a lot of time and also a lot of learning curve to set it up, while K3S provide this as an add-on, so this is really simple. And last but not least is that it is yet secure and simple. So K3S is really maintained really well, and they provide regular updates, so you can also update K3S cluster or the Kubernetes version when there is an update very easily using their guides. So now let's take a look at the requirements. So I'm only mentioning here the minimum requirements for the K3S because we will be installing a single node cluster, which is right now enough for us for normal daily use cases for testing and deployment. But you can check in detail information about requirements using their docs. So here, if you go in installation and click on requirements, you can get all the in-depth detail like what's going on and how to set up for large clusters if you want to. And yeah, so this is really nice that they have very clean and correct documentation in my opinion, which makes sense to be honest. So yeah, so for the architecture, it is available in this, but we're gonna use the 64-bit architecture on our virtual machine. K3S works with almost all Linux operating systems, so yeah, there is no secret there. Hardware requirements. So this is really where it stand out among others. So the minimum it needs a one CPU core, and the RAM you can give for minimum is only 512. This is really amazing because even in Minikube, which again not bad, but at that time it also required more than 512 MB. And with the passage of time, things are getting increase and increase. Of course, you can increase the RAM. It's not difficult, but it also come with the performance issues and so on when you have not that much available. For the networking, so K3S need server port 6443 to be enabled, which is so that it can be accessed by all nodes. So let's get to the installation part. So prerequisite will be that it's good if you don't have a swap disk space enabled on your machine. You can disable it, but if you are, for example, for testing purpose, creating a new virtual machine to test K3S, you can check my video where I have explained how to create custom partitions and simply do not create a swap partition as well. I have here's the link to my video. So step one will be the setting up the Linux OS. So I will be using CentOS in this demonstration, which is really easy for me because I use this a lot and it works well. So let's get started. This is my CentOS up and running. And let me just make it more accurate. So the first thing is to update your machine using this command. You can use dnf minus y upgrade, or you can use also yum if you are using CentOS 7 version. And I would recommend to reboot it and then after install some of these other packages and again do the update. Since my machine is already up to date, so I don't need to do it. The second part will be to disable the firewall and clinux. Okay, so you can do like systemctl stop. Let me check the status. Okay, it's active, so we can stop it and disable it. And we can also disable the clinux part as well, which is defined here. Let me correct a small typo. So we also need to disable the clinux as well. So what you do is that you open this file in the editor. So I will use the VI editor. And it is currently set to enforcing. So what I will do, I will set it to disable. And I save and exit. And the third part is to set up your host name. So it will be set up the host name. Sorry for the typo, but this is how in real life things can happen. Mistakes always happen, which is good. You can correct it. So for setting up the host name, you can just type, you check your host name via host name command. And in my case, I have already set it up. So how you can set it up on your case? So you can first view it in etc host. Or let me do also VI here as well. And what I did here is that I define my virtual machine server IP and then give it the host name. And on the local host part, I also define the host name which I want to give up. It is always good. It does not bite back, but it's always good to define it. In case if you forgot, things can still work, but I prefer to give every machine any individual host name. Now we will come to the part where we have to install the required packages for the K3s installation. So I will simply copy it till here because I am running CentOS 7, so I will be using yum command instead of DNF. So it will install all the packages. Okay. And then what one thing I would do is that, which I missed here, is that I need to reboot because when I set up my CLinux permission from to disabled, so it's better to reboot. So I will just reboot my machine, so just to be sure. Okay, the reboot is done and I'm back in my machine. So the next step will be to run this script using the curl command. So I will just simply copy paste all of it. And now it will be installing the K3s cluster on our virtual machine. Okay. So far so good. It seems the process is completed. And it says also starting K3s. So this is important to see, like the last line, what it says about the service. So what we can do is that we can run this command, systemctl status K3s, and it says active and running. And we can see some more information here about these are basically the log lines, which seems like it's up and running. So now the service is up and running. And we want to see that if the cluster is really installed, because still we can't say like, hey, everything is up and running even with the status command. So let's use this kubectl command. Now remember, we did not install any kubectl special packages. It's all come from that curl script provided by the K3s. So let's use it. I paste this command here. Let me clear my screen. So now you can see that the services are up and running. Which is really good, and you can see all the information that it has provisioner, core DNS, and some other add-ons as well for traffic and so on, which is for ingress. And we can also check cluster version, I believe. It is called cluster info. So this is the Kubernetes control pane, which is running on this IP, on this port, and this is the core DNS, and we get all the details. Then if we do kubectl minus minus version, or maybe it's like this. So let me again just clear. So if we run kubectl version, we can see the client version of the Kubernetes. So it's the using the Kubernetes client version 1.28.5, and the server version is also the same. And it is also using customize, which is something different from Helm, which we will cover later. But for now, this seems to tell us everything that the Kubernetes cluster is up running using K3s. So now let's do a deployment of by creating a test case of Nginx server. So let's create this file. And let's copy paste all of this. So now we have Nginx manifest in this YAML file, and simply what we do, step two, is to deploy this file. So we run this command, kubectl apply minus f nginx.yml. Okay, so it says that deployment is created and the service is also created. If we do kubectl get pods, we can see that the pod is created and it's there, but it's getting created because the status is still zero and we need one pod. So let's wait for a few seconds while this is the command which we use, and we can also check for the deployments. So deployment is ready and let's see the pods, and the pod is also now ready. So now try to access this service. So we will first verify that the load balancer service is running. So what we do, we will do kubectl get service nginx command. And now notice here that this is the name of our deployment. The type is load balancer. This is the cluster IP, right, which is the internal IP of the Kubernetes. And this is the external IP, which we can use to access outside of the virtual machine in our local browser. Using the port. So let's do this. The port will be 8081. So let's try this out. And yeah, see, the Nginx server is up and running, and it was such ease to use it, deploy it, and without any hassle, where we normally in Kubernetes always have these problems like things are not working, or how to access it externally, and so on. So this is really helpful, I guess, for anyone who is either new or been using Kubernetes via other distributions, and now they can use K3s. So for wrap up, my keynotes are like this. So now we have learned about K3s, which is really lightweight yet very powerful Kubernetes cluster. It can be deployed in small in IoT devices to normal machines as well, based on your use case. And you can create either one cluster or can increase up to many clusters. It has really good documentation on their website, and it is also part of CNCF project, which is really good because it gets all the attention and using a lot of by professionals to test and improve its usability. Also, what we learn is that it can run inside a Linux virtual machine. So normally, why we prefer to run in our Kubernetes cluster in a virtual machine, because sometimes our Kubernetes cluster can mess up your local machine because it is using a lot of ports, and your local programs might be crashing and so on. So this is really good that it can be used in any virtualized environment, either using VMware, VirtualBox, or like me, KVM. So this is hence proof that it works. And the last but not least, that you do not need to worry about ingress or setting up some specific add-ons. It is already come as a package, so you don't need to need the extra overhead to learn it and then use it. So this is really cool. So yeah, I leave the documentation in this page. Thank you very much. I hope to see you in the next video. Please ask your questions in the comments. I will be happy to answer all of them. If you have any idea or thoughts that I should do a video on a new tool, or want to contribute with me, or just want to connect with me, just let me know. I leave my social accounts in the video description. And yeah, I will be seeing you in the next video. Till then, take care. Goodbye.